Have Ananth right now to talk about adjudication now.
I guess post lunch everybody is passionate about what they have to speak about, and yes, so this is something I am passionate about. The copyright board. So I stand before you not really as an IPR lawyer or as an author of a book. I stand before you because I 2 years back did something adventurous. I got to appear for one of my most worthy clients, Professor Bashir here, and for another association called Simca. Professor Bashir, as you probably know, has challenged the intellectual property appellate board, and the challenge is pending before the Madras High Court, and Simca had in fact challenged the copyright board. So these two adjudicatory bodies have been challenged on a very specific ground, which is that there is a constitutional infirmity and there is a constitutional non-compliance with a decision rendered by the Supreme Court in 2010 May. I am here to speak to you initially, of course, about what the Copyright Board does, its jurisdiction so far, that is prior to the amendment. Then, of course, about what the Supreme Court has said about tribunalization and how we must perceive this issue and how serious an issue it is actually. Third, about what I have seen in my limited experience of the workings of the Copyright Board, and finally what the copyright amendment does or it doesn't in order to address some of these grievances. The Copyright Board is probably as important as the Intellectual Property Appellate Board. Unfortunately, we do not realize its significance, because I think the significance is due to present itself before us in the next 10 years. The amendments are a starting point. The amendments give wide-ranging powers to the Copyright Board. But before that, what does the Copyright Board do, or what was it empowered to do prior to the amendments? The most important function of the Copyright Board is what we call the CL, or the compulsory licensing provision, under which you could prefer a complaint before the Copyright Board saying that there is a situation of unreasonable conditions being imposed by the copyright owner, thereby resulting in limited access to that sound recording or cinematograph, film, etc. As a result of which, the Copyright Board has to adjudicate on that complaint. So judicial power, as we know, when we do separation of powers in constitutional law, there are three wings of the government: the executive, the legislature, and the judiciary. Judicial power is ultimately the power to decide on a list inter partes, a list between two competing individuals or parties or interests. Here in 31, you see a classic instance of a list between two parties. You have a copyright owner who says, this is the value of my work. Yesterday, Mr. Pandey had addressed us on this very same issue, the tiff between the radio industry and the music industry. I am not on the merits of this issue at all. I am on the processual justice which goes on and which is contained in Section 31. So Section 31 requires you to make a complaint to the effect that you have tried your best to get access to this particular work on reasonable terms, and that this work is either being withheld from the public or that this work is being given to you only upon very unreasonable terms of access, as a result of which you are compelled to approach the Honorable Copyright Board. I can't think of any better scenario than this to qualify as judicial power. Similarly, the Copyright Board also hears appeals from decisions rendered by the Registrar of Copyrights on copyrightability. It decides on rectification petitions if a particular entry has been wrongly made in the register, but these are some of the lesser important functions of the board. The entire issue when it comes to judicial powers is the nature of the body that exercises this power. The Copyright Board is something that we had right from 1956. Unfortunately, perhaps the composition of this board was never seriously examined. Though there have been instances even in the past. Yesterday we spoke about the decision of the Supreme Court in Eastern India Motion Pictures Association. One of the strong reasons for certain royalty arrangements coming in the present amendment. This decision was in fact taken on appeal from the copyright board to the division bench of the single judge, and then the division bench of the Calcutta High Court, then to the Supreme Court. It was again a dispute under Section 31 where the copyright board refused to entertain it on an issue of law, which is that IPRS is not entitled to royalties, whatever that may be. 31 has been an important provision. Unfortunately, adjudication of licensing disputes under 31 has not probably got that much of focus or attention due to various reasons. Most significantly, because prior to 1985, even our perception of constitutional law and how judicial bodies must be constituted was very weak. If you look at our entire constitutional history, for the first 25 to 30 years, we largely fought over fundamental rights. We fought over issues like right to property, we fought over free speech, we had raging battles over election disputes. In fact, election disputes is where it all begins. When in 1975 the decision of the Allahabad High Court came, when there was an emergency imposed, when there were constitutional amendments sought to nullify judicial scrutiny over election disputes, the Supreme Court for the first time started looking at independence of the judiciary in a serious manner. Probably the political dispensation of those days, which inclined towards a committed judiciary and a committed bureaucracy, stirred further debate. In Indira versus Rajnarayan, the court finally sat, the constitution bench said, there is something problematic going on here, and that you cannot interfere with judicial power, with the independence of judiciary, with separation of powers, because all of this forms a part of the basic structure of our constitution. Soon thereafter, our constitution was amended with what we call the mini constitution, the 42nd Amendment. And the 42nd Amendment brought in a scheme of tribunals. So for the first time, you have a formalized scheme of tribunals. And this, when implemented in 1985 through the Administrative Tribunals Act, gave rise to the first huge litigation on constitution of tribunals, which is Sampath Kumar in 1986. Now, Supreme Court in Sampath Kumar had a wonderful opportunity to say two things, or to make two choices. It could choose to strike down tribunals and say that we are not going to have this form of justice dispensation. We are only going to entertain a system of dispensation of justice through courts, through the judicial process as we understand in our court system, through our court system. However, the Supreme Court in Sampath Kumar chose a different path, and maybe due to practical concerns, due to issues like pendency, it chose to address this issue of tribunalization from a practical point of view rather than a strict legal issue. So the Supreme Court took a view that we can have these tribunals, but when these tribunals substitute the High Court, they must be constituted in an effective manner. And this is where the entire litigation on the Copyright Board or the Intellectual Property Appellate Board today stands. And this is what has given rise to these writ petitions. So the court started tinkering with the manner in which these bodies are created and said, we'll look at two or three things here. One, we look at how the judges are appointed or how the tribunal members are appointed. Two, we look at their conditions of appointment. Three, we look at their qualifications. This, in the context of the Administrative Tribunals Act, led to the creation of a high-powered committee, etc. I am not on the specificities of that tribunal. Later on, after 12, 13 years of working of the Administrative Tribunals, again people felt that there is a, lawyers especially felt that these tribunals have not really fulfilled the promise. They are neither giving us specialized justice, nor are these tribunals actually addressing the issue of pendency. So again, you go back to Supreme Court. You had the seven-judge decision in Chandra Kumar. Again, the Supreme Court did not really say that we are going to strike down 323A and 323B, but let's look at it again from a practical point of view. Let's try to resolve some of these issues with the working of these tribunals. We'll go back to the correct qualifications, the correct appointment procedure, etc. Around this time, there was a proposal to, that is, when about 5 years later, there was a proposal to vest the entire company law jurisdiction of the High Court with something called the National Company Law Tribunal. So this was the third round of battle. And this was a round in which fortunately I could at some point in my career work on. What happened is that the National Company Law Tribunal, the provisions of the Company Law Amendment, were challenged before the Madras High Court and subsequently taken on appeal by the union, because the union lost before the Madras High Court. They were taken on appeal to the Supreme Court. Now here, again, the entire slew of issues were referred to the Constitution Bench of the Supreme Court. The Constitution Bench heard the matter in 2009, and in 2010 we have this decision I was referring to in the beginning, the National Company Law Tribunal decision, R. Gandhi, Union of India versus R. Gandhi, where Supreme Court went back to conditions of appointment, qualification and manner of working, and said that the provisions in the Company Law Amendment are unconstitutional for the reason that they do not satisfy the minimum requirements for judicial independence. The requirements, according to the Supreme Court, were that a body of this nature has to be headed by someone who is a retired High Court or Supreme Court judge. It can have technical members, but those technical members cannot be below the cadre of secretary or joint secretary. It cannot certainly be members of the Indian Legal Service. Judicial members cannot be a mix of bureaucrats and judges. It has to be, and lawyers. It has to be only those who are qualified to practice law and who have had minimum 10 years as practice as lawyers or 5 years as district judges. So these were all conditions of appointment brought in. Similarly, I mean qualifications brought in. Similarly, there were conditions of appointment, like for instance a minimum 5-year tenure. These are all important. If you look at judicial independence, it's one thing to talk about it in the air. I mean, this is a theoretical concept. We need brilliant judges, impartiality, all of that. But how do you really ensure it when you come to the ground? You ensure it by getting the best people, the best qualified people for the job. You ensure it also by seeing to it that there is minimal interference with the fulfillment of these duties by these individuals. And for that, you have certain conditions of appointment, like minimum tenure, a chance of reappointment, which was not there in the company law bill, and that's the reason why the Supreme Court said that it's constitutionally not correct. This decision of the Supreme Court in 2010 got us to relook at the Intellectual Property Appellate Board and the Copyright Board, the provisions which created this. Around the same time, I had my first direct experience of a decision given by the Copyright Board. I am again not on the merits of 2% or whatever is fixed. I am on the manner in which the adjudication happened. Just sample this. In 2002, 31 petitions were filed for the first time by the radio industry. There was something called an interim compulsory license granted based on what the Copyright Board colorfully described as a best judgment assessment. This is something we normally see in taxation law, very unusual when it comes to adjudication of a dispute between parties. This went straight on appeal to Bombay High Court. The Bombay High Court struck down this decision based on best judgment assessment and clearly said that this is a quasi-judicial body which has to decide and can only decide based on the evidence. Went on appeal to Supreme Court affirmed the Bombay High Court decision, remanded it back to the Copyright Board. The Copyright Board led evidence. But in 2010, the Copyright Board wonderfully does something interesting, which is to pass an en masse order. It is not really a judicial order, it's an administrative order. It passes an order against all music providers in the country. When the only complaints, set of complaints, were against PPL. So there are associations like Simca, but Simca is just one of them. There are many music providers who have not been heard at all. You come back to processual justice, principles of natural justice. I honestly don't think, from the bottom of my heart, that this decision would have been come had this body been headed by a retired High Court or Supreme Court judge. Because it's very fundamental to any adjudicatory process that if a person is aggrieved by the outcome, he must have been heard. It's just principles of natural justice. Anyway, so this compelled us to relook at these provisions and challenge the constitution of the Copyright Board. 2011, in fact, January 2011, we filed these writ petitions, one on the intellectual property appellate board, the other on the copyright board. Since then, it's been pending before the Madras High Court, but during that point of time, we have this amendment. To qualify my statements here on the ground that I am someone appearing against the Ministry of HRD, but at the same time, I still feel that this amendment is a classic case of fake opportunity when it comes to giving us a copyright board that is competent to address the weighty issues which have been placed within its jurisdiction by the same amendment. Interestingly enough, these provisions on the copyright board were not part of the original bill, at least as far as I remember. When there were representations made before the parliamentary subcommittee, these provisions were not there. It is probably as a consequence of the writ being filed that these provisions have been brought in. But if so, I can only say that I am thoroughly disappointed, because these provisions do not in any manner address compliance with the decision of the Supreme Court in NCLT. As interests such as the public interest in access to the work, as well as the copyright owner's interest in monetizing his right, have to be addressed and decided upon. I really don't think